Welcome to our YouTube channel, Into the Darkness, where my friends and I play the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. I'm your host, Tom Rayleigh. Tonight we will be playing Episode 8 of Horror on the Orient Express, with yours truly as the GM. Our recap tonight is brought to you by... Actually, I forgot. Is it Richard or Jeff's going to do it?
It's going to be Jeff. I'll get it next time.
Oh, that's right. You did say Jeff last night. All right, Jeff. Take it away, Jeff.
Okay, thanks, Tom. So, last week we started off in the house of Dr. Lorien, and our investigators were in the backyard trying to compare the old blueprints from 1712 with today's construction. Dr. Lorien is kind enough to grant us permission to dig up his yard, and they agree to start digging the next morning. Dr. Lorien invites us all to spend the night, and there is excitement in the air as to what we all might discover. Dr. Lorien happens to remember receiving a letter in the mail, and he lets us read it. It's from a stranger named Edgar Wellington. Edgar has contacted our good doctor friend about the Sedevkar simulacrum. The letter proceeds to describe in vague detail what the statue is. He asks the doctor to write back, but the doctor tells us that he has not done that yet. Our Dr. Giles realizes an interesting piece of information. Veronique. Left arm has been disfigured from what appears to be arthritis, and what is also the left arm. Oh, and that is also the left arm of the daughter Kittery that was burned by the hot cup of tea. Dr. Giles also asked Dr. Lorien if he could sit in on his patient's consult the following morning. Dr. Giles and Dawkins get a 50-cent tour of Dr. Lorien's medical office. We have a nice chat with Veronique and learn that she is into opera. And that she recently saw a performance by, now I can't do it as good as you, Tom. Katerina Cavallaro.
Cavallaro.
She proceeds to play us a sample of her singing on the phonograph. As we're all chatting and socializing, Everett notices that there is blood dripping from the arm of Dr. Lorien. Yes, it's his left arm again. Dr. Lorien claims he was scratched on his arm from the rose bushes out back, and they have not healed and appear to be infected. Dr. Dawkins is able to make a sample of his blood/wound, and they are attempting to make a culture for further study. The investigators and the Lorien family all sit down for a nice French dinner. Kittery is a bit too excited, and her parents usher her off to bed early so the adults can talk. Around 8:30 p.m., Kittery rushes downstairs claiming to have seen the boogeyman. The investigators calm her down, and there's no apparent boogeyman outside. The next morning is where things really start picking up. Dr. Giles is observing Dr. Lorien's morning practice, while the rest of the investigators start digging up the backyard. Sure enough, they discover some stones and stairs that lead down to what is assumed to be the cellar. The investigators discover a handful of rooms that contain torture devices, various racks, chains, iron maidens, stockades, etc. In fact, in one of the rooms we discover two skeletons that seem to be dressed as a bride and groom, and there are other skeletons in the other rooms as well. The investigators continued forward, and they realized that up ahead is a faint bluish glow. There are balls of light in the room up ahead. The walls are completely covered in rose bushes, and they are glowing as well as changing colors. The glow reminds us of the very first investigation with the ghost ship. In the middle is one large rose bush, and it has interwoven among skeletons. The skeletons are still gooey and dripping in a black goo. They soon discover a glowing arm, a statue's arm, but it's entangled in the vines. Everett manages to cut away some of the vines and freeze the arm. He takes the arm while using Frank's jacket so as not to touch it. As the arm is removed, the vines start to wither and die. They turn to ash, and there's a release of a noxious gas that starts to choke us. We all start to run out of the room. We glance back to see the roses and skeletons disintegrating. Dr. Dawkins suggests that we probably can't hide the arm upon our exit. And that brings us up to date.
And I forgot at the very end to at least let you get a look at the arm. So here's the screenshot that I had intended.
Oh, your arm. Can that be my actual arm right now?
It's cool.
Yeah. All right. So, you guys are still inside, and
so I'm going
have
to
some decisions to make.
I'm going to ask Everett. I would have noticed that he brought his archaeology gear and his canvas backpack type of a thing, and I would suggest for him to go up and say that he's gathering some more tools to excavate further. And with that bag, we can probably hide the arm in, and we can take it out with without them noticing, at least.
So you're going to put the bag in the arm? I mean, the arm in the bag?
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, I'd say that's what you think. Yeah.
Yeah. Does the elbow, like a working joint, or
no? It's stiff.
It's going to be, it's average, let's say 30 to 34 inches. It's going to stick out horribly. It would be like taking a mannequin and taking a school kid's backpack. I think that you're better off with a coat.
Or a combo of the both.
Because it's not going to bend. If it was going to bend, I would definitely agree that it's going to
fit. How big is this backpack of yours? Well, not a backpack, but like I'm thinking of a canvas, like a long canvas that you carry lots of tools in.
That would be a haversack. Or and something. That is like Civil War, as in like English Civil War. And I don't remember them being popular over in Europe, but I could be wrong. But it is what it is. What's your shirt size? What's your shirt size, GM? That gives you how many inches you have.
To the tip of my finger from my shoulder, it's 29 inches.
Shorty, I'm 34.
Yeah, but if you're a 34, that's from the back of your neck all the way to the tip.
Shorty.
This is from here. The arm isn't going all the way onto the torso. It's just from here.
I just think that a backpack is maybe 14 inches or so depth.
Oh, what are you guys going to do?
It's up to you.
Yeah.
Let it roll, see what happens.
I mean, we don't want to.
I mean, I can get my bag anyway and see if it fits, and if it doesn't, then go from there.
Yeah, just try that then.
Yeah, so that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go out and grab my bag.
Okay, so you walk out. Dr. Giles is out there.
So just to be clear, so the room behind us had this noxious gas going off. We were running to escape the gas.
Well, I told you as you were leaving... that it suddenly stopped. It was as if there was no gas there.
Oh, okay.
Now, you choked for a few seconds as if you couldn't breathe.
Now, let me ask you, was this like a gas or was it more like pollen? Like the crumbling of the flowers released?
As I described, it was kind of a purplish cloud.
Okay.
And I mean, it seemed that as the roses and the bodies crumbled to dust, it dissipated and it didn't. It just suddenly stopped. Okay. So you guys are actually, you're between the door and where those roots were. So you're still just inside.
Okay, sounds good.
Everett has just exited to go get his bag.
Okay.
And outside you have the doctor and his wife. Well, actually, my guess is that they're not just going to sit there out there and wait. So they've probably wandered back into the house for a while. You know, okay. You'll tell them what you find. So the only one out there is Dr. Xavier.
And Everett?
Yeah, so I'm going to go to the room.
Everett, I'm sorry. I didn't mean Everett. I meant, yeah.
Eldridge.
My opinion is that maybe we should talk to the doctor and his wife and maybe keep them as far away from this as possible, keep them occupied while we move the arm from the excavation site to maybe the house or maybe away from the house. Does anybody want to, you know, any input on that?
Yeah, that's probably a good idea. Tom, did we bring, like, trunks that would be big enough to...
You've never said anything. Of course, you do have your wardrobe, but I don't think that you brought your wardrobe with you to Poissy.
It's back in your
hotel in Paris.
Yeah, I remember that we were actually in a hurry to get to Poissy because our train was going to leave like within 20 minutes.
Right.
So we only had a quick pack up.
You weren't even sure that you were going to spend the night, but you
did.
Right.
Well, I actually, as part of my inventory, I have a satchel. It's an over-the-shoulder satchel that I take everywhere with me. I don't know if the arm would fit in there with all my stuff in it, but maybe if I took the stuff out and, divvied them up into my pockets or something like that, we could put the arm in that and I could just carry it out.
Well, we determined about 30 inches.
30 inches?
Going to need.
It'd stick out.
So, here's an idea. It's wintertime, I'm sure. Some of us would have maybe gloves or something. We could actually, stick it through our coat jacket, like keep our arm up. You know what I mean? And just put a glove on the hand. And
yeah, I have some leather gloves that I'm currently wearing.
You could probably hide it.
I'm in my game.
Tuck it under your arm, or I don't know.
What if you just had a long winter jacket?
You probably could.
I don't have a winter jacket. I have a trench coat. Go ahead.
Oh, well, if you've got a trench coat, then...
Yeah, that
could work. What I was thinking is that one of us could take the arm and go back to the other hotel where we were staying at in Poissy. We can come up with an excuse that, we came across some sort of dust or something like that, and he wasn't feeling well, or we can say that he's going to do a... he's going to send a telegram or something like that, so he ran into town real quick.
And it's,
so
basically, it's literally 5 minutes... walk.
Yeah, so we can make an excuse for whoever's going to carry out the arm. What we can do in the meantime is keep the doctor and his wife and the daughter occupied.
Okay.
Keep them distracted while the other one runs out with the artifact.
Okay. So I can put the arm then in my satchel and then kind of cover it with my trench coat. And I can just walk away. Essentially it just looked like me holding my coat and my bag, and as I just walked away, I don't think that looks suspicious. Does anyone else want to come with me? I have a feeling that this item is cursed. Even separated, it's still of some powerful magic. So maybe someone else would like to come with me.
I was going to say, I think I should probably take it since I've already been the one who's interacted with it.
Okay.
And if it is cursed, then why?
Well, I do think that you passed it to Frank.
I thought Frank just passed me his coat and I'm holding.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Maybe I misunderstood. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. So I'm the one who's holding it with Frank's coat around it.
Okay.
Bring coats.
Yeah,
I've
got
lots of coats.
Everett, you and I can just trade coats, and you can wear the trench coat and carry the satchel. I don't see why that'd be such a big deal. Or, I don't know that they're not still outside. So yeah, you can just take my coat and my satchel and, just walk away with it. Yeah.
Dr. Xavier, you were busy just now, but I told them that after the rest of them were inside the basement for half an hour or so, they got bored sitting there, so they went inside.
So they're on the other side of the door.
You're the only one sitting there. Yeah.
Can I hear them talking among themselves? Can I make a listen roll?
No, you really can't.
Damn it!
You're in the open air, but.
Damn it! Double damn it!
You could come down and join us.
Yeah.
No! I'm just gonna sit out there like, hey, what? Anything new? Hey, is that an arm? Can I give you a hand?
Oh no!
All right, so what's the plan?
I'll go up.
Tom, as we're talking, sorry, Wayne. As we're talking, I just wanted to ask: is the arm still glowing?
Not as much as it was.
Good. Sorry, Wayne.
It's kind of wrapped up, so.
What I was going to do is I was going to leave the sub area. I'll go up and talk to Xavier, let him know what's going on, and I'm going to need his assistance to distract the doctor and his wife.
Why don't we just leave the arm down there until the evening, and while everybody's asleep, recover it?
No. Let's take care of it now.
Okay. All right. Sounds good. What are we going to do to distract him?
Well, I'm going to go in, ask for a bit of tea, because I've been down here for a while, and I'm a little thirsty. And what I also want to do is examine the doctor's wounds to see if it's, you know, the infection has subsided, if it's still about the same. So we need to do some small talk or whatever, and I'll talk about what we found down there a little bit with the doctor, but tell him not to go down there because it's a grisly scene down there. So.
Oh, is it? Horrible.
Yeah.
Horrible.
Yeah, I explained to you about the torture chambers and things like that. But, yeah.
And then, am I to understand that Everett and Eldridge are going to go back to the hotel?
Is that what you want to do, Everett?
Yeah, I'd say it's probably better to be in pairs than one person by themselves.
Well, what about...
It's a good thing we're not going to split up the group, because I hear in this game...
Tom, could you do me a favor?
Hotel Ruin is just 5 minutes around the corner and past the church.
Yeah.
As the DM says, nudge, nudge, wink, wink, nudge, nudge.
I'm not a DM, I'm a GM.
Oh, I'm sorry.
There's no dungeons here.
Okay. Put it level up first. Come on, Mario. All
right.
Tom, can you do me a favor and move up the map of the property?
Yeah, let's see. Do you want the modern map?
Yeah. Okay. So what's going to happen here is, like, we'll come in on through the middle. We'll have them in the room to the right. I want you guys to, like, when you guys leave, I want you guys to go around the left way and get off the property that way so that they don't see you leaving. And then if they start to ask questions about where you're at, then we can go ahead and say, oh, yeah, we forgot to tell you. But by that time, you guys are going to be gone.
Okay.
All right. So, like, well, we'll distract them. We'll keep them to the right side of the house. And you guys can slip away on the left side.
Okay. Yeah, that doesn't sound like a problem.
Well, the left side is the doctor's office anyway, so.
Okay. Frank, what are you going to be doing? Are you going to be coming with us? Are you going to be coming with them? Are you going to do your own thing?
I'll probably go into the house with them.
Okay.
Because I don't have a coat. I'd be cold outside.
Okay.
All right. So, action.
So Giles, let's go into the house and grab some tea. It's a bit chilly out here anyway.
Absolutely, absolutely. Wonderful idea. Yeah, yeah.
And all of right. course, Frank, if you want to come along with us, that's
sure, please.
Yeah.
So the three of you head for the house or head for
yes.
the door.
Yes.
And the other two of you go around the other side of the house and out the gate.
Okay.
All right. So as you walk in the door, you see Kithuri is playing on the floor, and Veronique is sitting there in a chair reading, and she looks up and she's like, oh, she says, so what's down there? Did you find anything? And you hear the doctor in the kitchen, and he immediately comes in as well. He's like, would you guys like some tea?
Oh, wonderful idea!
Absolutely.
Yes, please.
So, did you find anything interesting down there?
Well, yes, but it's a bit grisly for, you know, women and children down there. Apparently.
What do you mean grisly?
Well, apparently the previous owner of this property in his basement had...
Can we move into the kitchen and talk?
Yeah. So we go into the kitchen and in a lower voice we say, I'll say that seemed to be like torture chamber. Several torture chambers down there.
Really?
Yeah.
Horrible. I don't know what to say.
Well, I am shocked as you, Doctor. I don't know what to say either. I think this is horrifying. Hmm. I think that perhaps that we should seal this tomb up.
I don't think we can do that. I think that we need to alert the authorities.
Well, you can. I would imagine if you do alert the authorities, they can remove the torture devices from down there and catalog them.
We can open a museum.
Ooh, yes.
At least 200 years or 150 years old.
And I mean, even if you, you're probably, as a matter of fact, there is a museum, a quite strange museum in Paris, which these particular devices might actually fit quite well.
Hmm.
I'm actually referring to the one with the
flayed skin.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean Fragonard's museum. Yes, I've been there.
Yeah.
But, I mean, torture devices are actually pretty popular.
They're pretty in popular style.
Things for people to look at, you know.
Ooh.
And to find out that there was a torture chamber underneath my house, that's very interesting. Anything else interesting down there?
That was just about it. I mean, a lot of large roots, but, you know, apparently you've had your garden pretty much underneath it, so... But these roots were... What do you grow in your garden? Because these roots were quite thick. You have any, like, bushes or trees?
Well, there's
like
trees that? In the backyard, yeah.
Okay.
Good fertilizer.
Yeah.
So is that all you found, was just some torture devices?
We found a few skeletons down there as well.
Oh, my God. There's skeletons?
Yeah.
Oh. That would be good for the museum.
We'll alert the authorities then.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Dear me. Dear me.
Pull yourself together, man.
I lost one sanity last time. I'm looking at the thing. Ah! One sanity.
So how extensive is it down there?
It goes... I mean, I forget the actual... Out of character, I forget the actual measurements of it. But there's several, it's about five chambers, if I'm correct. Is
right.
it five?
Yeah.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, it's about five
really?
Chambers.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, this four, is very exciting.
Four to
it
the
is.
Side, yeah, and one straight ahead.
It is, Doctor, but I would like to ask you for a professional courtesy. If anybody asks, that I wasn't here.
Hmm?
Oh. I wasn't here for the discovery.
Oh, I'd miss you if that's what you wish.
I do wish so. I really appreciate that.
Yes, this Dr. Giles is he's quite a modest man. So he doesn't like a lot of attention.
No, absolutely not.
This
could be your discovery.
And yeah, actually, you guys are fine.
I wish to take nothing from your family or sweet, how do you pronounce her name, Kitterly or Chitterly?
Kitterly.
Kitterly. I would not want to take from your child, Kitterly.
I don't think she'll want to use the torture device of this.
No, I don't think that she does. But when you bring this and everything is cleared out and you make this a museum, I think this would be a fine attraction.
If that's what you decide to do.
I think he should, absolutely.
So anyways,
Dr. Lorien's House of Horrors.
Yeah, indeed, monsieur. Although, so you guys sit and drink tea and you talk mm-hmm. about this. Riley, I'm sorry, you had something else?
All I was going to say is, as we're talking and discussing, I'll say, let me take a look at your arm to see, has it gotten any better, you know, since we applied, you know, some of the aloe and the...
That's only been, overnight, or yeah.
I want to make sure that it's, you know, the infection is...
Well, he holds out his arm, and he looks at it himself, and it actually does look like the spots that were necrotic are no longer, they're kind of bright red, but they're not dark any longer, and the red rash seems to be disappearing from around it.
Okay. All right. Oh, it looks like finally it's starting to get a little better. Just keep that wrapped up for a bit. I mean, well, you're a doctor, of course, mm-hmm. so you know how to take care of yourself, but I'm glad that it seems to be getting a bit better. Are you feeling great? Are you feeling
good? Well, I hope. It has gotten better before and then immediately then came back. We'll see.
Yeah.
Can I also suggest that we sit on this discovery for at least a day?
Oh, yeah. Well, of course. I won't call the authorities until tomorrow, if you wish.
That's what I was thinking. Just to give us time to think about what course of action we all want to take.
Yeah. Well, I do need to head back to Paris. I have some pressing matters. I've had a wonderful stay. Mr. Coates, could you take my picture with the family?
Absolutely.
I would like to add this to my album, please.
Would you mind if I get in with...
Absolutely.
Okay. So we do all that. I will say, you know, I'll give him...
Exactly. Looking down.
Yeah, I'll give him, the information at the hotel, with the hotel that we're staying at in Paris.
Okay.
And I say if you can, if anything happens or if you need any assistance with anything or just want to chat, this is where we're staying in Paris.
Okay.
And feel free to call. I mean, it's great. I mean, thank you for your hospitality. Your wife and your daughter, you know, everyone here was wonderful. Yes, just let us know if you need anything further. And, yeah, I do want to know how your arm ends up turning out, if it's gone for good or if it comes back. I'm just curious.
Okay, monsieur. As you wish. So what are you guys going to do?
I'm going to make sure that I have his address, and I'm going to add it to my journal, and just try to remain charming, and dismiss myself from the conversation, and wait for the others outside, and skedaddle, because I know what's going on right now.
All right, Eldridge and Everett, what are you guys up to? You've reached the hotel ruin.
Okay. Are we back in our rooms, or are we just in the
sure.
hotel?
Sure.
Okay.
Ask if they're all on the same floor.
Come on, you have to meet the front desk woman.
Oh yeah, you have to. I call her Large Marge. I love her.
All right. Well, after we do the investigating into the actual arm thing, I'll go talk to Large Marge. Okay. So, I'm who has the arm? Does Evan have the arm?
Yeah.
Okay. So I guess it's more a question of what is Ever gonna do.
So I didn't really take a good look on the arm. Does it have any like markings, like?
So you're taking it out of your jacket and you're going to take a look at it.
Yeah, I'm gonna inspect it.
You notice that it has appreciably changed color. It's moved from kind of purple to blue to maybe a blue-green in color. Okay. And it's lighter. There also seems to be... Now, are you actually holding it?
Yes. Or I'm, like, holding it.
It feels smooth. Smooth like glass. Smooth like porcelain. It doesn't weigh very much, but it does weigh... I mean, it doesn't weigh like it's solid marble. Okay. That would weigh a lot. It weighs pretty much like what an arm would weigh. It's physically... I mean, proportional to your own arm. Go ahead and do... Well, I don't think you need to do a spot hidden. As you look at the arm, there seem to be markings on the arm. And when you look at the markings, you realize that there's kind of a pattern, an overall pattern of the arm, of differently arranged things. And it suddenly dawns on you that what they are little arms. It's almost like you're looking at little drawn pictures of arms all over it, and they're in swirls and patterns, and they seem very intricate in places, like around the knuckles, and they're a little larger on the flat areas of the arm, and they all seem to interlink with one another and form this overall pattern. Go ahead and do a spot.
36, that's a pass.
Okay. As you're looking at these patterns, you begin to discern that there are little swirls, little places where the arms are arranged in circles. And in the center of each circle will be little tiny arms that are kind of random, but these little circles, and I'm talking small patterns. You're looking very careful. It seems to you like they're pointing like to a spot on the arm. And when you look at your own arm, it's right where you've got a mole on your arm. And the more you look at it, the more you realize that for every mole or dot on your arm, there is a corresponding spot on the arm that's mimicking exactly everything on your arm. You also begin to realize that the arms in the arm are also composed of little arms. So you can't see the details, but that arm, that little arm pattern there, is actually made up of little tinier arms. So you're kind of, I want you to do a sanity roll. You'll only lose one sanity, but you're, in either case, you are extremely surprised by this revelation.
Okay.
Everett, what are you doing? I'm sorry, Eldridge, what are you doing? You notice is that he's looking intently at the arm.
Okay. Can I do an occult roll?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And 20 out of 68.
Cool.
Okay.
What were you thinking about on your roll?
I'm thinking about why the shift in color. Like, is it a glowing color? Is it, like, illuminating off? Or is it just the shape of the rock, the color of the rock?
It... You don't know. The change was gradual. And as time is passing, as you're sitting here, it's continuing to change in color. It's getting lighter and lighter. It's moving from green to yellowish. And it, instead of the dark purple that it was, it's almost become... Well, you imagine that if it progresses, it'll turn white eventually.
Okay.
Meaning all the illustrations are going to be disappearing?
I don't know.
I mean, like, what's actually changing?
Just the color is changing so far.
Okay.
Okay. I look at Everett, and I say, "Do you have a pencil? I only have a pen."
Yeah, and I pass him pencil.
Okay, so I'm going to reach into my coat pocket, pull out my investigator's notebook, rip out a page, and you know what? I'm going to be cautious about it. I'm going to take my handkerchief out, put it in my left hand. I'm going to then take the paper, put it on the arm, and take the pencil and just, like, do a pressing of it.
Do a rubbing?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't want to lose the valuable information. What do I see as I... Is it just the arms?
You get nothing at all. It's as smooth as glass. No features at all. And it's also now about the same time that that you begin to notice that there is a pattern under the a pattern to the design. It wasn't really apparent to you before, but now that you're a little closer to it, you can see there's definitely a pattern in it.
Okay.
Can't really make out what the pattern is, but
look into the arm. You are getting sleepy.
Would I need to do a spot hidden roll to see the pattern, or could I do an occult roll?
Well, occult, you have to tell me what you are what are you researching in occult?
Nothing
in your occult knowledge tells you anything about this arm.
No. I'm more or less trying to figure out if this was done, if I can look at the pattern, and assuming if I see the same thing as Everett, that the arms and the literal arms, if it was even possible to make this with the tools that they had at the time.
I think that's more of a history role.
Okay, well, that's even better. I think that's better. It's not particularly better, but 45. Just gotta get a 45. Nope.
Well, I can at least say that nothing in your experience. You can't imagine. You've seen objects to art before, but nothing that compares to this. This is unprecedented in anything. You don't even know what the thing is made out of.
Okay.
It feels like ceramic, but it's as smooth as glass. So you don't know how the pattern was applied or anything.
And I look at Everett, not really knowing what an archaeologist does for my character, and asking, do you know what this is made of?
Should I do a roll or just...
It won't matter because you don't.
Okay. Yeah, then I'll say, I haven't seen anything like this before, so...
Fake it like you know it.
I'm going to take a step back and crumple the paper with the rubbing that shows me nothing. Okay. And just, like, shove it in my pocket. And I guess I just sit on the bed and, you know, wait for Everett to take charge, because I really have no idea what to do in this situation.
By now, the thing has turned almost completely white. However, you can still see the pattern in it.
Okay.
What would you like to do next?
Eldridge,
all you saw was the general overall pattern. You didn't look close enough.
Yeah, no. All I saw was lions or something like that, I assume.
Okay. Then I'm going to...
And Riley hasn't said anything to you, so...
Yeah. So I think I'm going to look over at Eldridge and say, what did you notice anything specific about this, the pattern that's going throughout this arm?
I take out the piece of paper and open the paper, and I say, what pattern?
Okay. Then I'm just... I'm going to say, I've been looking at this arm, and I'm going to hold out my arm and show him, like, point at one of my freckles and be like, do you see anything correlating between this freckle and the pattern on the arm?
Okay. Sure. So I'm going to look closely at the arm, see okay. if there's any... there's anything to note. I'm gonna roll spot hidden.
Go ahead and do a spot hidden.
Yeah. Yeah, 46 out of 55, so just passed. So I look and I see. What do I see?
When you look, you notice that you do now notice that the arm is composed of little arms, and they do seem to be in a very distinct pattern. And Riley is pointing to a spot on it that doesn't seem particularly anything at all. There's arms there, but there's no particular arrangement on that spot. But you do see spots where there are circular arrangements, but they're not where Riley's pointing.
So I'm guessing that they match the circular motions of my left arm?
You check that? Yes, they do.
All right. Do I need to roll a sanity roll? A sanity check?
Yeah. In fact, are you going to say anything?
let's do the one sanity check before I make Riley do one. 67. So no. So I failed. So I take one.
Just one.
Okay. Okay. So I then look at it and I wish there was like a science roll that I could do, but there isn't. And I say, that looks like mine. And I I sit up and I approach Everett, who's holding the arm.
That's really weird, because to me it looks like my arm.
So... you have come to the conclusion that each of you sees in the arm your own arm, mm-hmm. or at least the patterns that seem to match all of the spots in your arm.
As I'm looking at the arm, looking at, you know, each individual mark, I leap to the conclusion that perhaps the statue, when perceived by whoever, you know, was looking at it, represents, you know... who represents whoever's looking at it. So if the full statue, if I were looking at it, I'd see myself. If you were to look at the full statue, you'd see yourself.
That's an interesting hypothesis. I'm going to be very interested when we get more pieces to see if that's true.
I shake my head and I say, I'm not. And I just go and sit back on the bed and begin writing my findings. Because nope, Eldridge ain't taking none of this shit. Nope.
Okay. Do you wanna do anything else?
Before
I jump to the others again.
Not really. Just kind of right. Keep it.
So you guys are in there talking and worrying. How about the rest of you? Are you guys leaving the Lorians?
Yeah, we've left and we're heading back to the hotel.
Okay. So you arrive shortly thereafter back at the hotel.
Do we see Large Marge?
Yeah, she's there behind the desk. He says, good evening, gentlemen. I don't remember what voice I use now, so I'll never get that voice again.
I love it!
Pretty close.
As if we can get some bath towels.
You're going to take a bath, monsieur?
Oh, yes.
Hold on just a moment. And she goes into a little room and comes out a few seconds later with a stack of 3 or 4 bath towels.
Would you like the red towels?
I was waiting for that.
We don't have red towels.
We don't have red towels.
We don't have red towels, monsieur. What's wrong with you?
So I take them. Yeah, I did it as a joke, but I take them.
Okay.
And I say, nursing. And I head to... Whose room are we meeting up with? I guess we'll go to either... We'll stop at Everett's room first to see if they're there.
Okay. So you go up to his room, and they're there.
Okay.
And they both look kind of... They kind of look a little pasty, like they've kind of freaked themselves out. I don't mean to imply that they're actually getting ill for some reason. I just mean they look kind of...
Like spooked. Yeah. Gentlemen, what seems to be the issue here? Are you guys all right?
Everett?
just some things that we've noticed about the arm.
Do tell.
Is the arm still out?
I think I've somewhat hidden it. Like, there's, like, a jacket over it.
Okay.
But it's not, like... completely, like, hidden right now.
If any of you can see any part of it, you notice that it's white now instead of purple.
Well, I'm going to ask Mr. Coates to take a picture of it anyhow.
Sure, absolutely. I'll head to my room and I'll get my good camera.
The good camera.
The good camera.
I look at those who are still in the room, because Frank's, run off to grab his camera. And I say that anyone who perceives the statue's arm sees their own arm, in fact. So I've come to the conclusion that the full statue represents whoever's perceiving the statue.
Hmm.
Do I perceive that it's true?
Yes. As each of you examines it, you all notice, once it's pointed out to you, you notice that the arms are made of arms and that they form patterns and that the patterns correspond each in turn to your own left arm.
You're so that for sanity?
Well, they kind of told you, so you're not
shocked.
We're not
shocked by it.
You know that it's an artifact of some weird type. But
Okay, the inception of our inception. So I'm going deeper into the dream. Yes. When Mr. Coates gets back, I'm gonna let him do his thing, and I'm gonna take some notes, and I will go to my room and update my journals, unless somebody needs me.
Okay.
Before you leave, Doctor, does it look anatomically correct?
I will see if it's got 5 fingers, four fingers and 1 thumb.
It seems perfectly anatomically correct.
How tall would this person be? Can I guesstimate? We're going to need a bigger bag, guys.
I don't know that you can actually do that from an arm. Because people have different lengths of arms.
Right. So, like I said, that's the reason why my hypotheses are my guesstimate.
Normal average
human. About 6 feet. If when it's assembled.
How tall is your character?
How tall do you want me to be?
Well, whatever.
I gotcha. Okay. All right. I guess that's it for me. I guess we're gonna have to wait till morning. And who's gonna
I well, just
I just thought of something. Everett or anyone, does anyone have a tape measure? Dr. Xavier just gave me an idea.
We can ask Large Marge if she's got a tape.
If we can determine, if one of us can determine the length of the arm, we can see if the size also changes with whoever perceives it. Because, you know, if the arm changes in shape, then it's not really, you know, completely physical.
No, that makes a good point.
Mm-hmm. You know, because if it shifts to the size of the whoever's viewing it, then it doesn't. Then what does that make it? It's not a physical item at all. It's some sort of incorporeal metaphysical thing. So, does anyone have anything that we can use to measure?
I have twine, and we can use that just. Instead of like being precise with like measurements, just be like, okay, this is the length of an arm.
Right. So many cubits, and we'll just tie a knot at the end and have the next person measure and see if it's short or longer. How about that?
Yeah, no, that's smart. So what position is the arm in? Is it straight, or is it brought up? Is it like curled?
I thought it was curved.
Yeah, I thought it was curled up like that. Because we could always... Okay. I really hope it's not, like, a metaphysical item, because then things just...
Are getting weird.
It just makes things more complicated.
Yeah, it's kind of bent.
Okay, so...
Slightly.
So why don't we do it from the forearm, the base of the elbow, to the wrist.
Okay. Yeah. That sounds good with me. Yeah. Who wants to go first to measure?
I'll go first, since I carried it.
Okay.
Okay.
And you got the twine.
And I have the twine. So.
It matches Riley's arm perfectly.
Okay.
The length of the fingers, the length of the thumb, the elbow to the wrist, everything matches Riley perfectly.
Okay. Who's next?
Let's do Dr. Xavier next.
All right. I'll take it, and I'll write my measurements down. And I noticed that my findings...
How are you writing your measurements down?
On the wall.
I thought you were just using string to compare.
Yeah, we're just using twine.
Yeah. Okay. I'm using the twine, and I'm actually physically going to mark... 32 or 29 inches.
Well, here's the thing. You very quickly realize that it's difficult to pinpoint exactly spots on your body. It seems kind of close for you. But, you know, is this the tip of your finger, or is this the
right.
tip of your finger?
Well, let me ask... I'm going to stand next to Everett, and say I am... I'm sorry?
I'll just make it easy, because you're all going to sure. probably do this. And it matches Riley. You're sure that it matches Riley. If one of your arms is really radically different, it doesn't match.
Gotcha.
But if your arm is close to Riley's, then you don't know whether it matches or not.
Gotcha. Okay. So, interesting.
So what if we did it like this? Okay. Out of character, who has the largest size? I have a 50, which matches Everett, I'm pretty sure.
I'm a size 60.
Okay, so I'm smaller. Mm-hmm. Which means that I could do it, and we could see if it shrunk. Or we could do it to where if someone has a 70 or an 80, which I don't think any of us have.
I'm a size 60 as well.
60 as well.
That's the problem, is that you're all very similar.
What yes. about what about Frank?
I'm a 50.
Large, what about Large Marge downstairs?
No. But I think Tom already basically said that.
Right.
If we're slightly smaller, it doesn't match.
It doesn't seem to change size.
Right.
Okay, so it doesn't seem to change size, it just changes shape.
And it doesn't... No, the pattern changes.
Yeah,
that seems to be the only thing that changes.
Okay, so... So then it itself is a physical thing.
Right.
It's not, like, metaphysical to whoever perceives it. It's physical. So that means that if we take a picture of it, that maybe the same thing will happen if we perceive it. It just shows us what we want to see. So
what you're saying is if I placed a ruler next to it, took a photograph, and then I had a different photographer with the same ruler and, of course, the same arm, we would get different results? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, whoever perceives the arm sees their arm.
Interesting.
Yeah. So the size doesn't change. The shape doesn't change. It's just the pattern.
What would happen if you take a picture, and when we look at the picture, the same thing happens. You know, you perceive it one way, I'll perceive it a different way, so on and so forth.
I don't know, because the item is still corporeal. I can still touch and feel it. It's not, you know, it's not morphing in any way.
I mean, it's a interesting experiment, but we do need to preserve some film, and I don't know if Frank has that much film. I don't, you know, I'm not in your inventory or anything like that, but it's totally up to you to do that. But what I'll do right now while you guys are discussing this, what time is it?
It's about 7 o'clock now.
PM?
Yes.
All right. I'll take a walk to the train station to see what time the next train will come, and I'll purchase our tickets.
Probably smart.
Yeah.
Get it taken care of. Okay, so that just leaves us with the debacle of, are we going to take a picture of it or not?
So Theodore, you've left, yes?
Yes.
Okay. Are you guys going to take a picture of it?
I don't know.
I thought I asked Mr. Coates when he first came in to take a picture.
Yeah, I assume that he's... Okay, you've set up your camera.
Yeah.
The good camera.
Right. And so describe how you're going to take it, or what you're going to do.
So I'm going to put it on someplace where I can get good lighting from the window.
It's dark outside.
Oh, right. It's 7 o'clock.
I think I have a flashlight. I think I do.
That's gonna involve a large...
Camera. You probably have a flash for it.
Yeah.
The kind that makes noise, but...
I'll set up the proper lighting for it, then. I'll take one picture to get an overall size of it with something to compare it with a well-known object.
Very good.
A coin maybe, or... I don't... You know, we already established we don't have a ruler, so...
Okay.
What about a pen?
Well, pens are pen. You know, like if we're back in the States, does an American pen match a French pen? Whereas, if it's a coin, we know exactly the dimension of the coin.
Okay. I don't think I have any coins on me.
I'm sure you all have some coins on you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or a franc. What else? So I'll do one picture definitely where I get the entire arm.
Okay.
One picture where I would like to zoom in and try to get as close as I can to get the pattern.
Okay.
And maybe, unless anyone else has an idea, I'd also make like one picture to... Actually, I wanted to ask you that first. Where the arm is cut off at the shoulder,
mm-hmm.
What does the joint look like? Is it just completely smooth, or
It's completely smooth.
So maybe just the one picture of that joint section, unless anybody else has any.
We can probably assume you take a few more, a close-up of the hand, a close-up of the, you know. All right, you take a few pictures.
Okay.
All right, now what you guys going to do?
Mr. Coates, do you still have that letter from... I don't believe you returned it to him. from Mr. Ellington or Wellington?
Wellington. Yes. Yeah, I
Wellington.
Have it.
Yep. Okay. All right. No, I just wanted to mention it again. It's still fresh in my mind. I wanted to write, before I go to bed, I will update my notes and I'll sit with Mr. Coates and we'll have our evening chats as we usually do with some brandy or something. But I will not ask Large Marge whether or not she has anything to drink.
About this time, Dr. Theodore comes back. Dr. Dawkins comes back. Train leaves at 7 a.m. And he's got you all tickets.
Oh, great.
Good thinking.
So what's the plan when we get back to Paris? Are we moving ahead to our next destination right away, or are we staying in the city for like another day or two?
Something I'd like to bring up that we need to start thinking about, this is the first piece of we don't know how many, but we need to figure out how we're going to store this. Sure. Are we going to be carrying it around with us as we investigate further pieces? Are we going to store it someplace, hopefully?
Well, the problem with storing it someplace is, I mean, we have other people who are looking for this. So
right.
If they discover it, then we'll have to track it down again. I suggest that we take it, but while we're in Paris, we can probably pick up some more luggage so we can store this stuff in here. It'll be part of our carry-on, so...
Yeah, like, what if we just posed, like, a crate or trunk like luggage, put some clothes in there, and just put the arm at the bottom and then put clothes on top?
I'll just interject and say, remember, this is 1923. When you travel, you've traveled to Europe, you've taken your whole wardrobe with us. You've got trunks, you've got, foldable wardrobe things,
right.
And you've got
steamers.
You've got steamer trunks, yeah.
Yeah.
So if you had one more, or if you wanted to use one, just put it on the bottom. You've got plenty of hiding places.
Yeah. So what if we just did that?
Yeah, I think that's the best is just use the luggage that we have.
Because at least with the trunks, it can be on the train. It's in a safe place with us. And then off the train, it's in a safe place with us.
Right.
But if we're in a city and something were to happen, if we were to be jumped and it were to be taken, then it's gone.
True. At the same time, if we stored it somewhere and somebody took it from us, we would have absolutely no clue who took it. So it would be even harder to try to recover.
You also wouldn't know it for a long time.
Correct. Yeah. The other thing I had in mind, which is equally... risky, is to actually ship it back to Miss Katonic and ship it back to our the Arcane Society. The problem with that is if you get lost at sea, there's a million and one things that can happen.
Well, and that we need it in Constantinople.
Eventually, yeah. I mean, we can, but if it got there successfully, we know where it's at, and we have it stored. So when we have all the pieces stored, we can ship it back over to where we need to go.
I thought the instructions were we were to find all the pieces and then destroy it.
Correct. The idea, though, is like if we shipped it back to Arkham, each piece at a time, we'll have all the pieces eventually, and then we could ship it back to where we need to go to destroy it.
But I think that's going to take way too much time.
It will, and it's too risky. So the best option, in my opinion, right now, is to take it along with us.
Mm-hmm. What if we rented a storage space or even an apartment?
Again, especially if we have somebody that we haven't seen yet tail us, they can easily break it to our storage units.
That would be unlawful, though.
Of course, but so is murder. So is getting somebody alive in the
library. Ah, good point, Doctor. Yes.
What if we did like a compromise of the first two ideas where we take it with us on the train, and then we hide it in a trunk under clothes at the hotels. So that way, we can always check on it. Hotels, if we pick nice, stable hotels, they'll know, who is in rooms, they'll be able to at least, if someone were to come into our room that's not one of us,
they'd be able to be like, oh, this person went into this room at this time, unless they broke in, and I doubt that they'd want to break into a nice fancy hotel. So,
No, murderer hobos. Gotcha.
You know, so maybe we can do a little bit of both. Maybe we can take it on the train, keep it with us, and then take it with us and leave it at the hotel, so that way it's always with us.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Being people who have a little bit of money and people who are in the 1923s and the hotels you're staying at, you know they're pretty damn secure. I mean, they don't let people go upstairs unless they're staying there.
Yeah. So unless, you know, unless the Turks, unless those Arabs, you know,
Young Turks.
Yeah. Unless they, you know, unless they pose as, you know, hotel staff, which I don't think that they're gonna do, you know.
They would know their own staff.
Yeah, I think that we'll be okay. So maybe we should take Wayne's advice and bring it with us, but leave it at the hotel. Don't take it with us on trips.
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay. That makes sense. You wouldn't be carrying around a steamer trunk on a trip anyway, so, you know.
Oh, this is just my steamer trunk. There's nothing in it. Absolutely nothing. You don't need to examine this, officer.
All right.
And actually, I wonder if they make these things. Like, if we were to get a trunk, getting a trunk with, like, a false bottom.
That would have to be something that you would have manufactured custom for yourself.
Okay.
It would take
a long time.
It would take too long. Yeah.
Okay.
So, I assume that you guys chit-chat for a while, and eventually you go to bed.
Yes. I want to get out I want to get up 2 hours early. Five.
Okay, so I wonder how you dealt with that back then. Did they have? They must have had alarm clocks.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just assume you all have alarm clocks.
I thought they had knocking services.
Not at Hotel Rue, and that woman is sound asleep at 5 o'clock in the morning.
God damn it, Large Marge.
I hope to see her in Germany. Is that your sister?
All right.
I'll say this, like, for the evening, before I go to bed, I will take a stroll. I don't know if anybody else wants to come along with me, but I will take a stroll to go back past the Lawrence place, just to not knock at their door, but just, like, walk by and make sure everything's okay.
Okay.
We did leave rather suspiciously.
We'll just say you made up an excuse that you were going to go back to your hotel.
Well, that's what I said. I had to go back to Paris. I couldn't stay that long, and I felt that overstayed my welcome. I wish to correspond to you via postal mail, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. Have a nice day.
All right.
Stay in touch.
Okay. All right. So, let's see. Dr. Dawkins, you do that, and you walk around. It's a peaceful night. It's kind of cold.
Mm-hmm.
And you all end up back at your hotel eventually and go to sleep. And 5 o'clock comes, and Dr. Xavier, you wake up. And by 6 o'clock, you guys are all up because you guys are going to go down to the train station. And you didn't bring a lot with you to Poissy, so you don't have a lot of luggage.
Right.
Actually, that does bring something up because you probably didn't bring a steamer trunk with you.
So, it's still wrapped up in a coat, Mr. Coates.
You're just going to carry it then?
Yeah, I'm assuming so. That's how we got it here, I think.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, just lay it across your lap, maybe.
Okay.
Everett.
Yeah, I think like the same way that we got out of the basement into the train is how we're going to get it through Paris.
All right. Well, no, nothing particularly weird or frightening or strange happens. You get on the train just fine, and you take your seats, and they serve a kind of a light breakfast on the train. What was the trip before? 2 hours or an hour and a half?
I think it was 2 hours.
Two hours.
All right, it's the same.
Before we wrapped it in the morning, could I have also taken a picture in the daylight?
All right. Okay, you say that now, but okay, I'll go ahead and let you have that one.
Okay.
Now, here's the odd thing. Let me ask you this. Where was the arm? Was it wrapped up like on the table or whatever during the night?
I'm going to say it was wrapped up under the bed.
Okay, wrapped up under the bed. All right. So that morning, before you leave, you're going to pull it out and take its picture again. When you unwrap the arm, it is once again purple.
Hmm. Glowing again, or?
No, just purple.
Just a color change.
Hmm. That's a little unsettling.
Well, the sooner that we get back to...
I'm thinking it probably has something to do with the time. The time of day, basically. Maybe as it gets later in the day, it starts to fade a bit more.
Well, as Frank is taking its picture, and I will say that the arm is sitting there for... 20 minutes, you know, while you guys are getting ready to go to the train station, and you've been taking this picture. It has once again been getting lighter and lighter. Again, it goes through blue and then green, and it's heading towards yellow.
Does anything change when I look through my camera viewfinder?
You mean as far as the patterns and stuff go?
Right. Like
no, nothing is moving on the arm, but what you are seeing through the viewfinder is the pattern of your own arm.
Okay.
The same as everybody else is seeing.
Mm-hmm.
So I assume then you wrap it up.
Yep.
And you guys get your stuff together and you go get on the train. And you travel for a couple of hours, so 9 o'clock. You arrive back in Paris at the train station. What are you going to do? I don't want to say I assume. But just tell me what you do.
Oh, please do.
I'm going to go ahead and take the arm back to our hotel and put it in my trunk.
Are you all going to go back to the hotel?
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay. You're now... there, and when you were at the train station, the next train, the Orient Express, will be leaving Paris at 2:53 p.m.
Today?
Yes.
Jeez. Okay.
In reality, it didn't really happen this way, but I've got it scheduled so that every 8 hours it goes.
Okay.
So that's the next train that leaves. One of them just left not too long ago. And it left at that 6:53 a.m. It left.
So
did you happen to keep track of what day it was, Tom? I lost track. I think it's around like the 24th or 5th.
Okay.
It's the 25th.
Right. I'll see if I can figure that out.
Because you were in Paris, and you got on the train, and you went to Poissy, and you spent the night, and now you're on your way back. So it's just been, you know.
It's been probably a day, yeah.
The next day.
Yeah.
So what's our course of action? Are we going to get on the train at 2:50, or are we staying here another day?
It would be 10:53 p.m. would be the train after that.
Yeah. So
I don't know. I mean, what do you guys feel like doing? Because, you know, I don't mind leaving under the cover of darkness. There'll be less people out, and we'll have a clearer view. of anybody following us. At least that's my goal.
This is going to sound like really random. Did we ever really like continue the investigation with the guy, the ghoul in the catacombs? I know that sounds really random and I'm really hung up on it, but like, why is there a ghoul in the catacombs?
Well, they actually went back.
Oh, you guys did.
You were there. Don't you remember?
I remember, but we didn't. He said, go away, and we didn't do anything else. I'm curious as to why he's there. I don't know, you know, I don't know why that would be there, that would be brought up if it didn't have some significance to the story. And you can correct me if I'm wrong, Tom, because
No, you're asking me to give you information that absolutely not.
Almost got him.
Yeah, I almost got you, Tom. It was close. This was close.
This isn't my first time running this campaign.
Oh. All right.
Do you want to do some further investigation on this front, or do you want to leave? I mean, we actually came and we got what we came for. If your curiosity wants you to continue this investigation, we can hang around a bit. But the longer that we stay, the longer we can't get our main mission done. So,
well, how long, Tom, do you think it'd take for me to go back down there, with maybe someone who spoke French, and solve this? Or maybe I could buy a French to English dictionary and then go back down.
We've got one of those.
Hooray! I go, how long do you think that whole process would take? Do you think I'd be able to make the train?
At 2 o'clock? Well, I mean, you might be able to do it, but...
Because what time is it now? It's like, if we left at 7, 9.
Right, well, then you've gone back to your hotel.
Yeah, so it's probably like 11, yeah.
Well,
10. All right. So what? That's like so 4 hours. Plus, I gotta grab my bags, my passport, go through customs. Yeah.
And it took you an hour to get through the.
Yeah.
Just get down there.
I don't know. I'm in the minority here. I'm of the curious minority.
Well,
so
what do the rest of you think? Yeah. I can go one way or the other. So, what do the rest of you think?
I'm not opposed to it. I mean, you're not necessarily under any kind of strict time.
You okay there, Riley?
I'm fine.
Purple fingers over there.
I don't know why that would have been brought up if it didn't have some significance. And my character Eldridge is just really curious as to why there's someone who looks like that living in the catacombs and no one's done nothing about it. Or maybe they tried doing something about it and nothing's worked. I don't know.
I want to step in and say I don't like when people are playing me. Your character can make decisions based on your character. Can't make decisions based on the fact that we're playing Call of Cthulhu.
Yeah, no, and I'm trying to base my character his decisions because he's curious, but he's also wary, which is contradictory, I know, but so I guess, but he is also a vocal minority, so he's leaving it up to the people who you know who are the most vocal, which are you four. You know, so if you guys want to stay. We can stay and do some more investigating. Wouldn't be opposed to that. Or we can continue on the train. You know, it's up to you guys.
Where's the next stop? Are we going to Germany, Italy, where?
Do you have maps?
Not to mention, did we solve everything we wanted to find with the asylum?
We can't get into the zone. We had that one shot, and we kind of blew it.
Well, yeah. I mean, if we're going to hang around, then we were going to see if there was a tunnel leading to the asylum underground and see if we can get in through that way. I remember talking about that before we left.
I don't feel like walking in crap.
Well,
is it through the sewers, the tunnel to the asylum?
I was going to see if the catacombs actually lead to the asylum.
I think that's too dangerous.
I mean, the idea here is if we get ourselves a compass and we know the direction of the asylum, we could just pretty much use the compass to navigate the
And what if you hit some ore, my friend? Some unknown metal compound that renders your device useless. What would you do then, sir?
You mean like another magnet or something like that?
Perhaps.
Well, to interject in a more practical way, there's nothing north, south, east, or west about the catacombs. They're a maze of tunnels going everywhere underground on three or four levels. There's no way to know that you'd actually be going in the right direction.
Are we sure you guys spent the trip to the asylum? Like, that's just, like, absolutely, like, you cannot go back inside of the asylum looking like how we look and being who we are. Because the catacombs didn't sound like a bad idea, but now that Tom said that.
Well, then, I mean, there's always the sewers as well, but like Dr. Xavier says...
I'm not gonna be walking through no crap. I got alligator shoes.
What all did we investigate in France? I'm just trying to remember.
The reason why you went to the asylum in the first place was because Fenelik had been kept there.
Yeah.
At that time, you didn't know where Fenelik lived. And then you went
there. Yeah, so pretty much to be honest with you, we're pretty much done here in Paris as far as our main objective is. If you want to go down and try to find out what's going on with this ghoul, I mean, we can do that. There is still a possibility that we get lost down there, too.
True.
True. So you understand why I say that, because let's say here's Charenton Asylum, and here's where you go into the catacombs.
Mm-hmm.
You might, the only, if there actually were a way to get there, it might be like this. You know? Right. How are you ever going to know how to get there? It's amazing.
Well, I mean, the reason why I said take a compass is because no matter which direction the path takes you, you can always say, let's say for an example, it's to the west. As long as we're going west, even throughout a maze or whatever, as long as we're still heading west, we're going to eventually hit it. But that's sort of the idea. But I get what you're saying, because it can lead us southwest or northwest.
Or there could be a whole section of catacombs out here that never connects to the Charenton Asylum, and you're in the middle of it going west, and it never goes any farther, and you're just stuck. Then how would you know that Charenton Asylum was above you?
You don't even have a pace count, and they didn't even do pace counts until after World War II.
It could take you years. Yeah, there's no way to tell.
I mean, it was just an idea, but...
it's a good idea to explore, yeah.
Yeah, and you know, I was, you know, interested in what was in the cellar, you know, as much as the next guy wasn't here for it, though.
Well, yeah, we have that one guy that's in the private wing, but we have no... Go ahead.
I said no. We have no way of getting to him.
The only way that I can think of getting to him was they went ahead and they committed him. He probably might have living relatives, and that would be our only way in. We would have to investigate that. But if we do, we're Americans. Well, it seems kind of...
I mean, I'm from the good old England.
Actually, if you recall, he was an orphan and a foster kid.
Okay.
Okay. What about Frank and Everett? You guys have remained pretty quiet. What do you guys want to do? You guys want to go back on the train and what do you guys want to do?
Yeah, I'm not really seeing a need to stay, but if you guys want to stay and we take the 10:53 train, I would be fine with that.
If we took the 10:53, would that give us time to head to the catacombs one more time?
Well, yeah, you'd have hours and hours in that case.
Okay.
Okay.
I'd be willing to go
about almost 12 hours.
Yeah. If we want to do 12 hours, you know, let's do it. Why not? Yeah.
Okay. Sure. All right. 12 hours. Hiatus.
Yeah. Let's just not get lost then. I mean, the thing here is if we miss this next train, there's always going to be another one. So.
Yeah, but I don't want to stay in France this entire time. Can't speak French. Speak German. Let's go to Germany. Okay, so I guess let's go to the catacombs.
All right.
Okay. So you travel across town and you arrive at the catacombs, and they are open. You guys have gotten really used to that. In fact, the guy who sells the tickets, he's like, oh, you people again. You really seem to like the catacombs, eh?
And I think too, we wanted a translator.
Oh, well, you're standing at the catacombs. You didn't.
We have a French English dictionary.
Okay. So you go down into the catacombs. And I'm not going to put it up on the screen.
You don't need to. We know what happens. We
bones, 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 passages. And actually, you kind of realize, at least practically, that you could seriously get really lost. Because you're talking about 10 feet forward, 10 feet to the right, 10 feet to the left, 10 feet forward, 10 feet behind. Plus, there's all these other passages going off, you know, that have been blocked off because they don't want you to get lost.
What was that?
That was.
You suddenly hear this dark moan from somewhere.
Oh, time to get out of there!
Okay. You search around, and it takes you about an hour to find the spot where you were again. The gate has been pushed back into place. It has now not just got a chain and a lock, it's got a chain wrapped around it and locks so that...
Little sign says, no Americans allowed.
Yeah. Well, actually, there is a sign on it. It says forbidden.
Yeah, see, that...
That's that, just inviting?
No, and I'm saying this in character to everyone in the room. Why would they lock it up?
It's like, dangerous.
I understand that, that it's not part of the tour and you shouldn't go in there, but why the need to lock it up and put signs on it and keep people away from it, instead of just saying, like, oh, you know, we're just going to keep going down this way. Why do they feel the need to put locks on it?
I think it's like a perspective.
Let me answer the question. It's not the only gate with locks on it. There's locks all through here because they don't want you to go down certain passages. In this case, you guys have broken this gate twice. And they keep finding it, and... They don't want people going in there because they're going to die. They're probably up there right now waiting to hear the reports of missing persons who went down into the catacombs and never came back.
Well, I don't care. We're going to break down this gate.
It's the same reason why zookeepers have signs on animal cages like lions, rhinos, and hippopotamuses, and says the same thing, and people look at it and go, why do they have that gate there?
All right, let me go, you're in your voice, Dr. Xavier?
Yes!
So you are there, and you are relatively alone.
Okay.
As you were in previous times.
Should we do rolls to break down the gate, or should we just assume that we break down the gate again? Because I can do a roll. I can do a strength check. I'm going to figure this out. I am curious, and so is my character. We're going to figure it out.
I'll hold the twine for you, and I'll stay right here.
Sure. Yeah. Maybe. And maybe that's something that we should consider doing. Maybe consider, you know, having one person go alone.
Yes, and I will be more than happy to hold the string right here in the main corridor.
Yeah, okay.
You, sir. After you.
No, but it's a serious question that, you know, Eldritch asks is, maybe one-on-one, this person would be more talkative. You know, maybe
That's true. I just wouldn't want to be one-on-one with such a different person. It brings the hair back up on my neck. I just don't feel really good about it. And I keep remembering the way that it just told me to go away. I have a bad feeling about this.
All right, well, how are you going to get through?
Is there, can I do a spot hidden to see if there's a weak point?
You've already looked at this door a number of times. There are weak points, but the weak points are now buried in chain. This is what I'll do.
Okay.
There's enough room that three people could try pushing on it or pulling on it or whatever. I need you guys to do a strength rolls, but I need you to make a combined roll of at least 200 of the three of you. So which three of you are going to try to push it open? And you guys got to roll and give me at least 200 to break this thing.
Okay. I can push on it. I have a 50.
All right. So who else?
I'll 50 as well.
Okay. I wanted to know before you rolled.
Yeah, we're all 50. We're all 50 except for Dr. Giles.
That's right. 45 here.
No, but I want you to... Okay, so who are the three people? Everett,
me.
Eldridge, and Frank?
Sure.
All right, so roll your percentile and add them all together, and they come up to 200 you've made.
42.
I got a 76.
59.
Okay.
I'm terrible at math.
What was it? 59.
It's below 200.
Yeah, I think it's below 200. So you shake on it really hard, but it ain't going to budge.
Okay. Well, meh. Worth it. Worth a try. That's it. I guess we can't go in. Sad face, cries. whoever God is really must not want us to go in there, cries.
Yes. Yes. Yes, he said that. He talked to me at the last chapel.
Yeah, or we have someone looking out for us.
Yeah.
All right.
You had a chance. You did have a chance.
Yeah, we had a chance. Cry face. All right.
Dr. Dawkins, do you want to go help them?
You guys want to make another? I'll lend a hand this time.
I'll still hold the string for you though.
So do we want to do it again? All right.
We're here.
It can only be three people.
We paid for tickets.
All right.
Okay. I can do it again.
Nope.
But I might want to count this as a push.
Fine.
Oh no, I'm not doing it if it's a push.
Yeah, do it if it's a... Come on, no. I'm holding the string. No. What more could happen?
No.
Oh, I've already rolled a 4, which would have been awesome.
No, I'm not doing a push. No, I'm backing up. We're going back on the train.
No. If we do a push, He can tell us what the consequences are, remember?
I don't care. I don't care what the consequences
are. Oh, now you don't want to go through the
The consequences would be that you'd probably seriously hurt yourselves.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm all for that.
You want to play the game of a hernia?
I'm a doctor. I can help that. I got a pill for that.
Heal me, doctor.
All right. There you go.
Okay, Dr. Xavier, you push it down. I'll stand back.
I can't. I'm a doctor. Look at my alligator shoes.
All right.
They just scream.
You guys haven't accomplished anything, so you're going to make your way back out.
Okay.
And you're going to go back to the hotel?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You don't necessarily have to, but you're not going to make this train. You'll have to get on the 10 o'clock train.
Right. Which is fine.
Yeah. We'll make preparations to do that then.
Where are we headed?
It's actually almost at 11. 10:53.
I'm pretty sure that we're headed to
Venice.
The border of
Lausanne.
Yeah, the border of Germany, I'm pretty sure.
Switzerland.
Yeah.
Wow.
We're looking for that guy who wrote the letter.
You were on the, and you were getting on the Orient Express. Now, technically, you were on the Orient Express before when you went from Calais to Paris, but you were really on what they would have considered a connecting train. This will be the actual Orient Express you'll be getting on.
Okay.
Which means that the service is extremely good. You will tell the concierge the hotel. Your plans. You will go ahead and book ahead what hotel you want to stay in, and your luggage will basically be taken to the train and taken to your new hotel. You won't have to lift a finger to do it.
Now, the question here is, do we want to take the case with the arm in it?
Yes.
Okay, so we're going to keep eyes on that all the time, then.
Yes.
You'll really have eyes on it all the time. I'm just saying you don't have to lift anything.
Okay.
When they'll pick you up at, well, you'll pick a hotel, they'll pick you up, and they'll pick up your luggage at the same time. And, you know, it's like never really leaves your side.
Okay. What I want to do is put some sort of, like, marking in the carrying case that we have the arm on. That way, while we're traveling, somebody tries to do a switcheroo, we'll be able to identify the case.
Steamer trunks tend to be that way anyway.
Okay.
As you can see, you end up with little stickers and stuff all over your trunks as you've traveled and so forth.
But I want something extra. I do want something extra, just, you know.
Okay. Okay, so anyways, I'll just give it a quick one. What do you guys want to do until you're ready to leave on the train?
I am going to grab maybe two cases of some really good French wine for our travels.
Okay. Consider that the Orient Express is like a 5-star hotel.
Okay.
The food is magnificent. And they probably have a wine cellar. I don't know what, or at least they pick
it
up.
No, they would. They would. Most winery trains.
I just want something.
It's a fully stocked kitchen and chefs and.
Yeah, I just want something for my private stock.
Okay, of course, yeah, absolutely. Anyone else?
Yeah, I'm gonna do a sidebar with Mr. Coates. Mr. Coates, what do you think about bribing Maurice? I think that's his name.
Maurice?
The attendant at the asylum.
Oh, that wasn't Maurice. No. Maurice was our interpreter.
That was Remy.
Oh, was that Remy?
Maurice is your concierge at this hotel.
That's what it is. That's the reason why. The French people, they all look alike. They all sound alike. Ah!
You already have tickets for the train.
I know. I was just, as in character, it just kind of like came to me when we were down there in the catacombs, and I was holding the string.
You're talking about Mr. Mandarin.
Yes.
To get back to the asylum.
Yeah.
Yeah, the thought did cross my mind.
Do you think we could bribe him?
To what gains, though? That's the question.
To get to the private wing and to get intelligence on that gentleman. That's the only thing else I can think. Think about it. Greek. Who speaks Greek fluently? Even though he was gibbering, it seems so strange. Like, for the others, the dog thing, which was more fearsome. I don't fear a patient that lies in a bed that's tied down.
And then we also had the other orderly.
Who is committed, that Martin, he saw.
Martin Guimart.
Guimart, yeah. Guimart.
Yeah. And that's the only way I can think. That's the only way I can think of getting in, because they turned me down already.
And I don't know how much difficulty we'd have. Like, maybe not necessarily. I mean, he was basically our friend. You know, we became friends with that guy.
Yeah, but I don't want to get him into trouble. But
right.
It was just a fleeting thought. I just thought of it while we were down at the catacombs.
Yeah. No, I hear it.
Do you think we should pursue it or carry on with our mission?
We can ask the rest of the group.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's wait for Dr. Dawkins to come back from his little side trip, and let's bring it up with everybody.
What's his side trip?
Wine.
Oh, that you've all done that. You guys are getting ready to get on the train. You've bought your tickets and booked your hotel.
Yep. So, you know, basically, I mean, if it comes up, I'll say, you know, we've already booked it. We're heading to the train now. I mean, if you want to come back later, we can do that. But, I mean, after we finish our main objective. Right now, we've got what we need. Basically, part of us going to the asylum is just to find out where we can go ahead and pick up this particular artifact. We've already covered that, so I say we move on. That's going to be my vote.
That's fine.
Okay.
Let's carry on.
Yep.
Okay.
Make a note of it.
So the time comes. You all go over to the train station. Your luggage goes with you. It's all the train is there. It's a beautiful train on the outside. It's all wood and chrome, not chrome, brass, and very, very, very pretty.
Stained glass.
It's not the diesel age yet. We're still back in the really pretty age. All of your stuff is loaded on the train, and you are shown to your rooms. Now, the train's not particularly wide, but there's corridors down one side, and there's rooms on the other. I would like to know how you guys have chosen your rooms. Normally, I mean, you could actually... People who are very wealthy can get a suite. However, the suite still sleeps two people. Most of the rooms are berths.
Berths.
The rooms are actually have places to sit inside, but the seats can fold up, and they have beds. So you can actually have four people in a room, two up above. It's like bunk beds, two above and two below. There also are some with connecting doors, small connecting doors.
Oh, so we can get a connecting room this time.
Okay. So, how many of you are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Six.
There are six of you. So you could fit into two rooms if you had three in each of them. What do you guys say? With a connecting door.
That's fine with me.
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay.
I'm down with that, man.
So let's just do room A and room B. Cabin one, cabin A and cabin B. Who's in cabin A?
I'll be in cabin A. We're in connecting rooms anyway, but I think there should be one doctor per room.
We don't have six. We have five.
Well,
Alonso.
Alonso is
manservant. Okay. That's right.
Surly manservant.
Dr. Dawkins is in A.
Yeah.
Eldridge?
I can be in B. I'm fine with being in B.
Dr. Xavier, I assume you and Alonzo are in the same.
Yes, please.
So A or B?
B's fine.
All right, so it's Eldridge, Alonzo, and Dr. Xavier. And the other two are with Dawkins. So we got Everett. And we've got Frank. Okay. It is 11 o'clock at night when the train departs. However, you know, there's stuff going on. Now, actually, I did forget to say something. As you were getting on the train, you noticed that a little ways down at another car, there were other people getting on the train as well. But there seemed to be kind of a ruckus going on. People were making a big fuss about somebody getting on the train. And what you saw from where you were is a rather beautiful woman dressed in really nice 1920s Art Deco-ish clothes getting on the train. And as she got on the train, she turned back to them and she blew them a kiss, and people were, you know, waving and stuff like that as she got on. And but you don't know one way or the other who that was.
I know if I remember our conversation?
No, you don't. I mean, you don't recognize this person.
I have a pretty good idea.
I don't know what you're talking about.
You mentioned it. Dr. Lorien's wife was chit-chatting with us.
Right, but just bear with me.
Okay. Right. Yep.
You get on the train and you guys get yourself together and you put yourself self together in your rooms, and you guys are kind of excited. Okay, you've had a wild time and a busy time, and there is a very luxurious lounge on the Orient Express where you can get drinks. You can hang out. You can relax. They have evening drinks, coffee, tea. They have alcohol if you want it. So I don't mean to control your characters, but I'm just going to say that you guys make your way there because you just want to see this train. It's beautiful. It's magnificent, opulent. The people serving here are all dressed in beautiful blue uniforms. They're very very efficient at what they do. They you find that they all speak English. They're all French, but they all speak English. They also speak, you hear them speaking to other people. They speak multiple languages. They speak German. There's other people on the train. And as you are sitting in the lounge, a man comes in first, and then a woman. And it's the woman that you saw. And she is, how do I say it? She is bubbly, almost beyond bubbly. She's, oh, darlings, we are finally going to Milan. I am so excited. And she goes on and on. And through other people talking, there's some people that are excited when they see her on the train. You do realize that this is Caterina Cavallaro, the opera singer. Okay. What I was saying earlier, Jeff, was you never saw her picture. You don't know what she looked like.
Right. No, I just put two and two together that a famous opera singer was traveling, and I made mental note that she was going on the Orient Express.
Okay. So you kind of figured that that's who it was.
Mm-hmm.
Let me pull this up. Caterina Cavallaro. And she is, I don't know how to say it. She's bubbly. She's walking around, oh, darlings, how are you? You know, and she seems to know a few people. And She notices your group, and she treats you as if she's known you all her lives. You know, oh, darling. And she sees Dr. Xavier, and she's like, oh, what a handsome gentleman you are.
Well. Do tell. Do tell. Here we go. Do tell.
And she's flirty, and she's sweet, and she's gracious, and she's and but she's also the center of attention.
Of course, okay? Yeah.
And she's laughing, and she's got a drink now, and she's drinking, and she turns to her the man who came in with her, and she's like, Charlie, play us some music. I feel like singing. And so there is a piano in this lounge. And so Charlie goes over and he starts to play. And the music, although it's on the piano, sounds very familiar. It's in fact the same piece that you heard at the Lorienz. It's Ritorno Vincitoro from Aida, the opera. And she sings it, and her voice is soaring, and it's beautiful, and it's amazing, even more so in person, because in person it's three-dimensional. It's, you know, it's amazing. And basically you spend a couple of hours in the lounge drinking, and he plays some music, and you end up dancing with her, and she flirts, and I mean, she's very sweet, and she likes you. She likes you all very much, and she eventually gets around to saying, she says, you know, darling, she says, in a few days, I open in at La Scala in Milan the opera Aida, which I just did a piece from. And she says, I would love it if you would come to the opera for opening night.
We must. Gentlemen,
must. It's in a few days. She says, you know what? I will arrange everything. And she gets all of your names, and she's like, I will make sure you stay in a very nice hotel right near the Duomo. We will have a marvelous time when you arrive. So
I'm smitten. Dr. Giles is smitten.
You're all kind of smitten. She is delightful. But you're all getting kind of tired. So you decide to
retire for the evening.
Call it a night. You're exhausted. You've done so much. You've walked the catacombs. You've recovered a piece of the simulacrum. And you all head off to your rooms.
I will, as we get to our rooms and we're in the privacy of our rooms, I will state to the rest of the people who are in my room that, you know, she seemed pretty nice, warm, and I don't trust her. I don't trust for anybody to have, you know, set up our accommodations ahead of time. So, you know, just somebody that we don't know.
Well, I've got to kind of emphasize that this was after 2 hours of schmoozing and...
Yeah.
I understand, but my cardinal rule is never trust a beautiful person. It just leads to disaster. So
I am but a moth to her flame.
Yes. You know what happens to moths flying towards flames.
Burn me, baby, burn me. Burn me with them eyes and that voice.
All right. So eventually, you all wind down and you go to sleep. You go to bed. And you find, as you're drifting off to sleep, that each of you begins to think about the events of the day and the things that took place. And Eldridge, somewhere way off in the distance, and this is just as you're finally drifting off to sleep, you hear that music, and you hear that screaming.
Nope.
Dr. Xavier, as you are slowly drifting off to sleep,
yes,
you can hear your aunt off in the distance calling your name.
No.
Dr. Dawkins, you can recall the frustration of trying to find your friend, Gregory, and being completely unsuccessful, and how upset you were over the whole thing. And Frank, you're standing on the ice, and your brother has fallen into the water, and he's gone under the ice, and you can see him under the ice, and there's nothing you can do to get to him as he's struggling for breath. And Everett, you're back in that hut, and you can see these red glowing eyes, and you can hear the screams of your comrades outside. But as you are all experiencing this, it suddenly all fades away, and you find yourself standing in a green open field. It's grass, and the sky above you is blue, and it goes off in all directions, seemingly as flat as a pancake. And as you're standing there with the green grass and the blue sky, you look down and you realize, well, it's not green grass, it's little red flowers. And they're pretty little red flowers. And the mountains that are all around you are all snow-capped. And the forest behind you. And the sky is kind of pink with big billowy clouds in it. And you're not quite sure what to make of it, but you are standing in a clearing in the center of a wood with a path in front of you, and that's when you realize that all of the rest of you are there too.
Oh, hell no.
And you're standing there on the path, and the first thing you notice, rather amusingly, is you're all dressed in what you were dressed in when you went to bed, which means that Eldridge, I don't actually know what Eldridge wears to bed.
He wears his just, you know, I thought it was like a white wife beater and just pajama bottoms.
Okay, but he's so always in his and he's wife his, beater in your pajama bottoms.
And, yeah, and he has his ring in his hand, like clutching
Dr. Xavier is in his red long johns.
Hell yeah.
And Dr. Dawkins is in his wool PJs. Frank is in a nightshirt and cap with, I think, nothing on underneath. And Everett is in his wool PJs, which look
sanity
a little
check. Sanity check.
And you're standing on a path that leads out of the woods and down the hill. And at the bottom of the hill, you can see that there is a village. Now, the village, which actually is quite close to you now, seems to be something from a bygone era. The buildings are made out of blocks of stone. There's wooden support beams, and the roofs are all made of thatch. And you notice that there are quite a few people in this village. The people are doing what people do in villages. They're, you know, tending to the sheep, and they're baking bread, and they're going about their business and washing laundry, and they sort of give you half a glance as you're coming into this town. The other thing that you notice is that there are cats everywhere. There are cats on the rooftops, and there's cats on the walls, and there's cats in the windowsills, and there's cats in the corners, and there's cats on the well. And as you enter the town, a lot of the cats take notice of you, and they get up from what they're doing, and they start to walk towards you. And you find yourselves in the very center of this town. The buildings all around you are, as I say, kind of medieval looking. The cats, many of them have now begun to form a circle around you. all staying about, 10 feet away from you. But it's become almost a sea of cats in this little town. The villagers seem a little bit annoyed that they sometimes have to step over a cat or around a cat. Some of the cats in the front seem very intent on staring at you, and some of them, of course, pretending to be completely indifferent and grooming themselves and pretending like they haven't actually noticed you, when in fact you know that they have. And then off in the distance, not too far in the distance, there's a larger building, still not very large. But a man comes out of the building, and he's wearing a funny black hat, and he's got a beard that's immense. And as he comes out, he's walking towards the circle where you are, and he gets right to the edge of the circle, and you notice he's holding a cat in his hand. And he says to you, oh, welcome, travelers. I am the Lord High Governor Atal, and you find yourself in the town of Uther. And I'm trying to bring up the picture. And the cat that he's holding in his hand is rather unusual looking, kind of blue. He takes the cat and he sets it down on the ground just inside the circle, and it starts to walk towards you. And let's see. It walks to Dr. Dawkins first and stops in front of him. Let me...
How appropriate of a name.
Yeah, well, now you know the name. So, what do you do, Dr. Dawkins? It's sitting there looking up at you.
I'll bend down and I'll hold out my hand close to it to let it sniff my hand.
And it sniffs your hand a little bit.
Go ahead. I was going to say, if it's not recoiling or anything like that, I go to like pet it.
Okay. As soon as you touch it, it of course reacts like a cat does, and rubs up against your hand. And there is an immediate reaction from all the other cats. About, I'd say 3 or 4 dozen of them, the closest ones in the circle, immediately come over to where you are and start rubbing a gum up against your legs and doing what cats do.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the other cats have become completely indifferent and just gone back to their windowsills and whatever they were doing before. And that's where we will leave it.
Oh, man! Tease!
Now, before we close up, I want you to do two things. On your sheets, I would like you to add 2 new skills. One skill is called Dreaming. And the other one is Dream Lore.
Dream Lore?
Yeah. So Dreaming and Dream Lore.
Question. Mm-hmm. What if we already have Dreaming as part of our skill set? As you and me discussed before.
Okay, that's fine. Then you've already got it.
Okay.
Okay. You may roll a 10-sided dice and put that score in both. You can do it for each of them.
Okay.
And write that score in there.
What about us mundanes?
All of you.
Oh. So roll 1d10 and add it to the same skill.
Add one of them to Dream and one of them to Dream Lore.
But, I mean, are we rolling once or are we rolling twice?
Twice.
Two.
And that's where we'll end it. Thanks, everybody, for your participation. Thanks to all of you for watching. We hope you enjoyed our game session. Remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you liked our show, please give us a thumbs up. Please tune in next Thursday night at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the next episode of Horror on the Orient Express. Until next time, always remember, if there's no light left to guide your path, your only choice is to venture into the darkness. Good night.